Hey YouTube, Joyboy here. So, chapter 959 of One Piece is out. So if you haven't checked out that chapter yet, I suggest that you do so because I will be spoiling you. But now that you have, let's begin. Finally guys, finally we have a chapter that I do not think is going to take 30 plus 40 or 50 minutes in order to cover. But yeah, I suppose that the essence of the chapter was that it was a flashback leading up to the events that we saw in the last chapter with the reveal that this was supposed to be the promised day. They were all supposed to go to the promised port. The nine red scabbards arrive and nobody else is there. And the port itself seems to be destroyed. So as was hinted at the end of the last chapter, the person responsible for this occurring is Orochi. And his methods are kind of interesting. It is certainly creative from Oda, but I don't know how much I really like it. So as we have discussed previously, Orochi seems to have some kind of inside information informing him about the movements, location, and plans of the Straw Hat Alliance. Using this information and his 9,000 IQ brain, he's like, well, maybe we should just destroy all of the routes to this port, destroy our very own bridges and important infrastructure, and seemingly based on the map itself, funnel the Straw Hats and their allies through the Flower Capital. If you guys don't know what I'm talking about, I recommend that you look at the map in the One Piece chapter itself, but you can see that almost every single bridge was destroyed except for those leading through the Flower Capital. Presumably, then he left Kiroshiro there in the Flower Capital as a kind of trap. So on a creative scale, I would rate this a 9 or a 10. This is something that I didn't see coming, and I find it to be very intriguing just as an idea. But just in the execution of it, especially with the forces that Orochi has available to him, it seems kind of ridiculous to me to destroy your own infrastructure and then funnel all of your enemies through your main capital, where I think that you would expect some kind of mass, large-scale battle. They have over 4,000 allies, all of which, again, based on the map, you're leading in one particular place, so the capital could very well be destroyed while Orochi is partying in Onigashima. And that just doesn't seem like something that Orochi should actively be trying to do. Another question that this raises for me personally is there enough support in the Flower Capital in order to defeat these allies? Is Kiroshiro going to be able to defeat them? Does he have enough people? Remember, Orochi and Kaido's forces number 40,000, but all of those troops are going to Onigashima and supposedly won't be there to stop this army passing through the Flower Capital. So I suppose my opinion about this plan would change if Orochi intended to leave a large number of his forces secretly, sort of waiting for the Straw Hats as a kind of trap before they arrived at the Flower Capital. That would make the plan better in my opinion. It could also be better if Orochi doesn't intend to fight them at all, but merely delay them, right? They send them on a roundabout way to this port, and then once they arrive in the port, they find out that they don't have any ships. All of this prevents them from interrupting the Fire Festival so that when Orochi returns, he can wipe them out. But even the second idea presumes that Orochi rates the Fire Festival as vastly more important than the possible danger to his rule of the country. Which, frankly, guys, is just really, really dumb. Not that Orochi is painted as this incredibly intelligent person, but yeah. Just as an example of sort of how I look at the situation and how Orochi could have perhaps handled this better is if you already know that the entire alliance is going to arrive at this port and then set sail for Onigashima, you can put your forces in place to take them out, all of them, at sea. Or if that is not an option, you destroy their ships and then cut them off and surround them at the port. But yeah, regardless of my nitpicking, Oda certainly did choose a route that is far more intriguing because a lot more things are possible, and I think it's just far more interesting as like, where are we gonna go from here? So in my opinion, here is where we stand after this chapter. The Straw Hat Alliance, none of the actual members were defeated. And so they all intended to go to the port, and they all intended to take certain bridges to go there, and they would find these bridges destroyed. If they found a bridge destroyed and it proved to be impassable, then they would look for the nearest bridge. That would lead them to the Flower Capital, which is where I expect all of the allies to converge. If you guys recall to my reaction to the last chapter, of One Piece, our theory was is that none of the Straw Hat members or Alliance members were defeated, and that seems to be the case, and they might already be in the Flower Capital in what is a kind of awkward wooden structure that could act as a kind of a Trojan horse. If you guys need a refresher on the idea of the Trojan horse, it's a famous story of the Trojan War, a fight between the Greeks and the independent city of Troy. Troy was this sort of impenetrable city. In order to get inside the city and destroy it from the inside out, the Greeks sent Troy this gift of a giant wooden horse, and inside the horse, soldiers were secretly there, and then once they were not looking at the horse, they could get out of it and then open up the gates. In the case of One Piece, in the last chapter, we got to see within the Flower Capital this giant wooden thing. People appear to be moving it or carrying it. There are people surrounding it, and the idea is that most or part of the Alliance forces is within this wooden structure, similar to a Trojan horse. An additional idea that I heard suggested that I really like is the possibility that Caribou could potentially be carrying thousands of people within him using his Devil Fruit ability. Thus, the Alliance could potentially fit thousands of people in a relatively small space. And so, guys, given what we learned from this latest chapter, I like this idea just as much, probably more, than I did before. It just seems as though this makes a ton of sense. If you are part of the Alliance right now, you have arrived at several different bridges, found them destroyed, and been forced to go to this port the very worst possible way if you are trying to remain secret. You don't want to go through the Flower Capital. That is the one place in which you are going to attract attention, you are going to attract notice. So this is the idea that I like, that I am going with for now. So the question then becomes, will they be noticed, right? I presume that Orochi will have given Kyoshiro orders to look for the Alliance passing through the Flower Capital. He should know of them at the very least. Orochi may not be that intelligent, but I personally think that Kyoshiro would be. Would he be suspicious of something, a plan like this? Or is he simply looking for a giant army to arrive at the doorstep and been given some amount of force to stop them? Another serious question I think here is, does Orochi expect the Alliance to go through the Flower Capital? We've talked about that, like, it's something that he should expect, and it is, but does he actually expect it? If he doesn't, I don't think anybody would be prepared. Does Kyoshiro even act against them if he were to notice them? That's another question, guys. I think that it's pretty apparent from the story that Kyoshiro doesn't particularly respect the Shogun. He has, at least on one occasion, specifically acted out against him, and he may want the Alliance to attack the Shogun, presuming that he can in some way excuse his oversight or guarantee their success. This is another thing that I'm personally really interested in. It's a huge question as to whether Kyoshiro becomes an ally of the Strat or remains a kind of enemy or some kind of independent figure looking for his own personal gain. If he wants to ally himself with the Strats as they're passing through his city, if he were to notice them, this would be the time to do so. You know, right now we're wondering about all of the samurai that the Shogun initially captured and is imprisoned in the Flower Capital. This is the time, I think, to free them, to set them free. Does this become part of the Straw Hat's objective, or is this a way, potentially, that Kyoshiro could help with their cause? But of course, now, as far as the Alliance's plan is concerned, there is at least one major flaw, and potentially two, where they don't have ships. Supposedly, these ships were destroyed. So guys, if you take a moment and think about it rationally, do you think that there is any possibility that these headliners took out Franky and Usopp and the group that were supposedly carrying the ship to Amigasa Village? I think that there is a 0% chance that that occurred. And I believe this to be important because these would be the people that are shepherding the ship across the land so that they could put it in place at the port. So to be straight up with you guys, I don't think that the important ships were actually destroyed. There was a line a couple chapters ago where Franky basically said, let's create enough ships to be able to carry 100,000. And then yet, in this very same chapter, he's like, okay, well, let's get our ships ready that can carry 5,000. There should be extra ships, and I think those are the ships that Orochi actually destroyed in the port. The important ships have already been moved. Another thing that I want to throw out to you guys is I personally think that there is a lot of credibility to the idea that this Trojan horse, this giant wooden thing, that we see in the Flower Capital might very well be one of these many ships. We know that the bridges that the Strand Alliance wanted to use were destroyed, so perhaps that led them through the Flower Capital with the ships that they were carrying all along. And so with this idea established of the Alliance potentially carrying many ships through the Flower Capital, they might be trying to blend in as part of the festivities, as part of the festival, bringing in ornamental ships to honor the occasion. We do know that the idea behind the Fire Festival is to mourn the dead, and that the residents of Wano create sky ships that we presume fly in the sky. So it would make sense to be building regular ships as well, potentially as another way of honoring the dead. But yeah, this is my belief for the status of the majority of the Alliance right now. The bridges were destroyed. They were forced to go through the Flower Capital. The ships that they were taking were not destroyed. And really the only question that we have for now, as far as anything related to the plan, is the status of the Thousand Sun. But you guys probably already know what I think about this, and I think that most people will probably agree with me. I don't think that it's particularly likely that the Thousand Sunny is destroyed. I think that it survived somehow. As for how specifically, I don't think we have a lot of good ideas. It's possible, right, that the Thousand Sunny is made out of Adam's wood, so maybe their explosion literally didn't damage it all that much because it's far stronger than they thought it would be, because Adam's wood is not present in Wano. They don't have communications and trade to the outside world. Therefore, they might know about this special kind of wood that is 1,000 times stronger than other kinds that they might find in Wano. In fact, the most important takeaway that I have about the destruction of the Thousand Sunny, put that in quotations, isn't its actual destruction, because I don't think that happened, but the Alliance finding the Sunny in that state, because that would be the most obvious clue in combination with the destruction of all the bridges leading to where they wanted to go, that there is a traitor. Somebody has betrayed him. Orochi has inquired intel about their plan, and that should have an effect on the Alliance and their plans going forward. This would be the second time and the second bit of evidence that their plans have been compromised. And I suppose the other thing that is curious to me is just how many people knew that the Sunny was there. I'm not certain if its actual location would have been revealed to everybody. So I'm interested in, I haven't done this yet, in looking back into Wano chapters just to see if we can get a list of people that for sure knew where the Sunny was. Because among those people, you might find the traitor. But I would say, guys, that my opinion is, as a result of all of this, the Alliance still makes its way and eventually arrives at the promised port with everything that they needed, that they intended to set out with. The only problem being that they are late. So we know that the 9 Red Scabbards are heading to Onigashima and that their chances of success are basically zero. So I think that still the Alliance and the Strats need to be able to rescue them somehow. Perhaps meet them just as they arrive or sometime very shortly afterwards. Another possibility that we discussed before is that Nekomamushi arrives with some amount of reinforcements as well at just the precise time and opportunity to save them. But anyway, there's two other things that I really want to talk about briefly from this chapter that I'm not sure that I have great answers for, but are certainly things that we should be thinking about after this chapter. First off is Jinbei's fate. I mean, Luffy brought it up in this chapter. We've been wondering, where is Jinbei? He's supposed to be here and he's not. Big Mom is here. If you guys recall back to the end of Whole Cake Island and the theories that were made during that time, nothing has really changed. So I think that my belief and the ideas surrounding this haven't really changed either. The best idea, as far as I am aware, is that Jinbei was defeated and was captured. If he was captured, he may have been brought along with the Big Mom pirates to Wano and is simply on Big Mom's ship with Big Mom's subordinates. It's additionally possible that Big Mom was able to steal a bit of Jinbei's life, or all of Jinbei's life, and put it into a homie. But I just don't think that Jinbei is dead. For sure, in my opinion, he is not dead. And if he is dead, or presumed dead, or if people think that he's dead, he's going to come back to life, because Jinbei is a future Straw Hat crew member. Big Mom may have also forced Jinbei to spin the roulette, and other options aside from a lifespan being taken from him include losing arms and legs, and that's a potential. And so the last thing I want to talk about is Odin, Wano, closing the borders, and the Kozuki family. I wanted to let you guys know, I am super excited for this next chapter and a continuation of the flashback, which it seems like this would be the right time to finally reveal Odin Kozuki's like entire appearance. It should, like, I feel like it's about to happen. Oda has built up this moment for so long that I can't help but be a little bit excited for it and whatever interestingness comes with that. But more specifically to the end of this chapter, Odin is talking to his subordinates about the importance and the reason for the border being closed and the importance of opening it again. I want to know the answer to this. I would like to sit here and tell you guys that I have some sort of great theory as to why this is, and I really just don't. I can understand the borders of Wano being closed for the country's own production. The Kozuki created the Poneglyphs. There's presumably a Poneglyph in the country itself, and therefore closing the borders and preventing anyone from snooping around or any enemies from infiltrating the country, that's good. That makes sense. This is actually something that I find to be quite common among the allies of the Ancient Kingdom, or people that are specifically protecting Poneglyphs. The fishmen, they're isolated, they're protected off in their own little corner of the world. The minks are the very same on the top of Zo, separated, isolated, and the Kozuki closed their borders. I think that it is no coincidence that all of these groups essentially are in the very same position. It's a position of relative safety. But for why exactly opening the borders would begin the process of turning the tides of the world, I don't know. I've always had this belief that the endgame of the Ancient Kingdom and the people, the constituents that were allied with them, their endgame was to find a way to live in peace with the rest of the world, to integrate themselves safely. So naturally, by the time that the story ends, Wano's borders would open, the minks would come down from Zo, and the fishmen would come up from Fishman Island. But I never really viewed that act as a thing that could turn the tides of the world. But yeah, guys, I'm really excited to find out exactly where Oda is going with this. As always, I'm curious as to what you guys thought about the chapter. Share your thoughts in the comment section below. Like the video if you like the video, dislike the video if you dislike the video. Make sure to subscribe if you want to be notified for my future content. And as always, guys, have a wonderful day.